Hello everyone, welcome to the MIF++ seminar, where I will talk about continuous metrics and chiralities of two-dimensional lattices. Feel free to ask questions during the talk, so raise your hand physically or virtually, or simply interrupt me. This is a continuation of some of the previous talks, and this work is joint with Matt Bright, who is present here, and Andy Cooper, the director of our Materials Innovation Factory in Liverpool. Since, yes, thank you, Matt. So since I have given several talks on this subject, I will go rather quickly over the first 10 slides, and then it will be slower after that. However, if you have any questions earlier, please let me know. So simply remind that we consider lattices, and in our mathematical definition, a lattice is given or is generated by a linear basis. And the key difficulty here is that the same lattice can be generated by infinitely many different bases, as you see in the first picture. In addition, we could shift our lattice by a vector, and when its representation, numerical representation changes, we could rotate this lattice, we could choose a different unit cell or basis for this rotated lattice, but all these four lattices is very natural to consider as equivalent, because we study crystal structures whose structures are determined in a rigid form. That's why our main equivalence relation on lattices is called isometry. So any map that preserves interpoint distances, composition of translations, rotations, reflections. If we exclude reflections, then we get rigid motion. But in the most general case, we study this lattice isometry space, so the space of isometry classes of all lattices, which could be in any Euclidean space Rn, but today it will be mostly two-dimensional plane. Then, formal statement of the problem. We are looking for a complete isometry invariant, which is a map from this space to a simpler space. So space which could be easily parameterized by numerical vectors, for example. And this map should be well-defined on isometry classes, so it should have the same value on any isometric lattices. Ideally, it should be complete, and later you will see, of course, complete invariants that distinguish all non-isometric lattices. And today, mostly we will, in the second half, focus on metric, or more exactly, a continuous function D on pairs of lattices. And this metric should satisfy the following metric axioms. The symmetry and triangle inequality are rather natural. And the first metric axiom is, in practice, actually the hardest to satisfy, because the distance between lattices by this axiom should be zero if and only if our lattices are isometric. And if we have such a distance, then as a consequence, we immediately distinguish all lattices up to isometry. But additionally, we would like to have a continuous function. That's why this metric problem for continuous distances is harder than simply a classification up to isometry. So a list of references as usual. And let me simply give one link to a part of my webpage where all latest versions of our papers are linked. And I have recently updated the mathematical part for two-dimensional lattices, and similarly the crystallographic part of the same research. So brief reminder of superbase. So in any dimension, if you have a lattice generated by a basis, it's very natural to add one more vector equal to the minus negative sum. And then in dimension two, instead of two usual vectors in a basis, we have now three vectors, so-called superbase. And it is called obtuse if all pairwise angles between these vectors are non-acute, 90 degrees or more, or obtuse. And this picture actually shows all possible obtuse superbases in the two-dimensional case. In dimension three, it is also known that any lattice has an obtuse superbase, but this three-dimensional case will be is much harder, and we will return to three dimensions in our later talks. Okay, brief reminder of the root invariant that completely classifies lattices in the plane. If you have an ordered obtuse superbase of three vectors in the plane, then we could consider the so-called co-norms, or sometimes like called also Selin parameters or Delaunay parameters. So we take negative scalar products of these three superbase vectors, and additionally take square roots to get units of original vector coordinates. So only for that reason. Now, if we put these three products in increasing order, then we get a uniquely defined triple, which we have called the root invariant. And briefly, the theorem says that any lattices in the plane are isometric if and only if with ordered triples root invariants coincide. Let me skip this example, which was discussed previously, but spend a bit more time on the sign of a lattice because it will be important later for the metrics. So in the plane, we could have a so-called mirror symmetric lattice or a chiral, which means that a lattice is simply equivalent to itself up to rigid motion, equivalent to its mirror image up to rigid motion. For example, you could imagine square lattice or any rectangular lattice, why mirror symmetric. But if you consider the lattice on the left and the lattice on the right, these two lattices were not mirror symmetric. So they actually mirror images of each other, and there is no rigid motion between them. So that's why it's very reasonable to somehow distinguish them. And we distinguish them by a sign. So if a lattice is not mirror symmetric, then it means that the superbase vectors have different lengths. If you have actually two vectors of the same length, then we can easily find the mirror symmetry along the bisector with respect to the bisector between these vectors of equal lengths. But if not, we could take uniquely, we could take two vectors of shortest length and take then the sign of the determinant. So in this order, the shortest vector, then the next shortest vector. And then we get a well-defined invariant up to rigid motion, the sign. So for example, for these two shortest vectors, the sign is positive, and for these two shortest vectors in the mirror image, the sign is negative. And if we add this extra sign information, then we get a complete invariant up to rigid motion. Okay, so you have also seen this triangular cone before in the previous talks. So if you consider all ordered triples, so they should be ordered, not negative, and the second number already should be strictly positive. Then all these triples they live in the triangular cone, so sketched here. So these are boundary lines, boundary lines of our triangular cone. So any point here uniquely represents an isometric class of a lattice. Then it is also to make the picture simpler, it's natural to project this triangular cone to this quotient triangle QT, the yellow triangle. And formally, we simply divide this triple of root products by the sum. By the sum, and we called it the size of a lattice. And the result, as a result, we get now a point with three coordinates in the yellow triangle. For example, any hexagonal lattice projects to this point with all equal coordinates. So if you draw this triangle in the plane, it will look like that. But also we make one more step. We do one more step and scale up this triangle by factor three to get an isosceles right angle triangle. So you will see why it is convenient shortly. So the quotient triangle, this yellow triangle QT, is now parameterized by projected invariant with two coordinates, x and y. And all hexagonal lattices here project to the top vertex, all square lattices to the right angle vertex. All rectangular lattices project to the horizontal edge. And here there is a brief computation. If you start from a rectangular lattice with a primitive cell A times B, rectangle, then the root invariant consists of three numbers, 0, A, B. So 0 comes from two orthogonal vectors, so the scalar product is 0. And it's easy to check that other root products are simply side lengths, A and B. And then under the projection, we get the number B minus A over B plus A. So a number in this edge from 0 to 1, the horizontal edge of the triangle, and the vertical coordinate 0. So this is Labrave class of all primitive rectangular lattices, class OP. The class of centered rectangular lattices is a bit more complicated. So it consists of two edges. Formally we should exclude like class of hexagonal lattices represented simply by a single vertex here. And also you remember this vertex 1, 0 is excluded because it represents the limit case when our unit cells become infinitely long. So either vertically infinitely long along this hypotenuse or horizontally infinitely long along this horizontal edge. So why is it interesting? So this space now represents, so it is the full continuous space of all two-dimensional lattices up to similarity. Similarity means a composition of isometry with uniform scaling. Any questions so far? Okay, so I have almost finished the revision of the previous talks. If you consider lattices up to rigid motion with uniform scaling, then we need to distinguish to consider the sign of a lattice. That's why our space is twice larger. So we have one more triangle of lattices with a negative sign. However, these two triangles should be really glued together along the common boundary, because on the common boundary, we have all mirror symmetric lattices. So they are the same in both triangles. So in this picture, I have glued two triangles along the hypotenuse, but additionally, we should also identify the left edge with the top edge and the bottom edge with the right edge. And if you visualize it now in three dimensions, you probably can see that we get not a torus, but a sphere without a point. So this point 1, 0 is excluded from the sphere. And since we get a sphere, it's very natural to parameterize it by geographic style coordinates, which you have seen previously. And now we have written exact formula how to compute the meridian and longitude coordinates for any lattice. So starting, for example, from the projected invariant given by coordinates x, y in this triangle. So we get a longitude and latitude coordinates on the sphere. So let me briefly remind that we choose the center of the inscribed circle and map it to the north pole. And then the boundary of the triangle maps to the equator. So that the equator now consists of all mirror symmetric lattices. So this is a natural continuous map, and when we extend this map in a linear way along this rays going from the center to the boundary, so they become now round arcs on the northern hemisphere, and similarly we add the southern hemisphere corresponding to negative lattices. Okay. So Matt is now working on producing circular maps on the sphere, but today we'll talk more about metrics. So now we are starting to discuss new concepts, so feel free to interrupt me and ask questions. So since we have a rather simple space, so triangular cone, parameterizing the all isometric classes of lattices, then of course we could define many different metrics, continuous metrics on this cone. So we could actually take any so-called base metric in Rn. In our examples, we will mostly use the Minkowski metric. We have a parameter q, and if this parameter q is 2, then we get simply the Euclidean metric. Right? So this is our base metric on the cone, and then we take this base metric between root invariants to get a metric on lattices. So the definition in this isometric case, so without orientation, is very simple. The orientation-oriented case will be actually much more interesting. But for the general isometries, the formula is very simple. Simply the distance between root invariants and similarly, up to similarity, the projected metric is the distance between projected invariants. So if you see the subscript q, or mostly it will be simply subscript 2, it means that we take the Euclidean distance between corresponding invariants. Then, if you define a metric, we should always check the metric axioms. So the symmetry and triangle axiom here are rather easy. They follow simply for the corresponding axioms for our base metric D. So let me highlight the first metric axiom, which is in practice is the hardest to satisfy. So the proof is rather short, but it is actually non-trivial. So what is non-trivial here? So what if you have a root metric equal to zero? Then this equation is equivalent to the fact that root invariants coincide. Why? So this equivalence follows from the first metric axiom for the metric D. So here we use the fact that D is actually a metric. But the second equivalence, it is simply the classification theorem up to isometry, right? So it is important to have a complete invariant. So only after that, it's easy to take a metric on this complete invariants, right? So this second equivalence is actually a big classification theorem. So that's how we get the first metric axiom for root metric and similarly for the projected metric. Any questions? Right, so it was it was an abstract definition. Now let's consider the examples, and hopefully you will have some questions on computations. Okay, so let's consider some simple lattices. So remember that this point represents all square lattices, and here I choose only one of them. So we could choose any point along this bisector in the plane for the root products R01, R02. So if you choose, say, 011 for simplicity, then of course it will be projected to the invariant 00, so to this vertex. And so that's how this square lattice is represented. Hexagonal lattice. So similarly, we could actually take any point here. So they all will project to by invariant 0,1 in the quotient square here. For the centered rectangle lattices, so it's a bit harder to see because in the quotient square, yeah, let's take the midpoint of the hypotenuses, a very simple point, but on the triangular cone, the corresponding point L0, so this actually the root invariant of L0, this point is located on that diagonal plane, on the inclined boundary plane of the triangular cone. So right between these two boundary lines. So the orange ray and the green ray. It's in the plane spanned by these lines. And Also, I mentioned the Lattice L2 Plus. Why? Because this L2 Plus was chosen right in the in-center of the quotient triangle. So the in-center is the center of the inscribed circle. So remember, this in-center was the most natural choice for our spherical map. And so that's why I highlight the coordinates of the projected invariant of this lattice. And also in the paper, there is a computation, showing how to produce a basis for this lattice. And here you see, you might think I have chosen somehow this lattice as a bit artificially, but there is a way to do it automatically within the so-called inverse design. So what I have actually done is consider it simple, interesting points in the quotient triangle and then reconstructed a lattice from that. So I have started from simple points x, y in the quotient triangle, then chose a simple size. So yes, it is a choice, but only to get simple integer coordinates for the root invariant. So if you have x, y, and sigma fixed, then we can reconstruct the lattice, and here you can see even explicit formally. For the vector lengths, it's very easy. For the angle, the formula is a bit longer, so it is on the paper, but here I specify that it can be easily found from the scalar product of these two vectors, so through the cosine of the angle. And the root invariant reconstructed or inversely designed from x, y, and sigma is explicitly written here as this particular triple. So why is it interesting? So it's interesting because now we can transform lattices continuously into each other. So if you imagine quotient square, any lattices, so any continuous path between them, even a straight line path, then going along with straight line path, we could continuously reconstruct and see how the basis of a lattice changes, because we have explicit formulae for this reconstruction. So this is, of course, a very fast baby step towards future investigation of potential phase transitions between crystal structures. Okay, one more geometric picture of the same quotient square. So now instead of gluing two triangles over along the common hypotenuse or diagonal, I have glued them along the vertical edge. But essentially, this is the same configuration space, the same space of two-dimensional lattices considered up to rigid motion. And additionally, also I specified some of these lattices with obtuse superbases. For example, the lattice L naught here on the hypotenuse at the midpoint should be centered rectangular. So that's how roughly it looks. So again, the exact formula for the vectors are in the paper. And then we have also two non-mirror symmetric lattices, oblique lattices. So L2, is what from the in-center, and L infinity. So yes, I have highlighted some straight arcs between lattices, but now you see that any two lattices can be easily connected by a continuous path, by straight line path. And we will now consider metrics on lattices up to rigid motion. So up to rigid motion, it is a bit more non-trivial. Why? Because, so what have we done previously? Previously, we have simply considered the projected invariant of a lattice. So now let's look at L2 plus the positive sign and at its mirror image, L2 minus. So two mirror images, so not equivalent up to rigid motion. So these two lattices, or any two mirror images of the same lattice, they have exactly the same projected invariant, right? So if you take a distance between them, it will be zero. So we do not distinguish them. We need something else to see what the distance between these lattices up to rigid motion is actually not zero. So that's why, yeah. So before that, yeah, let me show a simpler simple distance matrices, so these are distances between well, the previous lattices, but computed simply by using root invariance and projected invariance without any orientation. So if you look at root invariance, so for the square lattice 0, 1, 1 and hexagonal lattice 1, 1, 1, then so this Minkowski distance with parameter infinity means what we take the maximum absolute difference of coordinates, and here the maximum absolute difference is 1, so that's why we get these two symmetric values 1. Between these two lattices, this maximum difference is 3, so that's why you see here 3, and 6 is the distance between these two. And similarly for the projected matrix. Any questions on previous examples or these computations? So I have included here the simplest Minkowski infinity distance metric based on the Minkowski infinity distance, but of course you could also compute the Euclidean distance, and actually the formula given in the paper were simply a little bit longer. Okay, so if there are no questions on the simple case of lattices up to isometry, now let's consider what happens with orientation.
Excuse me, Vitaly, can I have some question? Maybe I have overlooked something, but I mean, all your tetragonal or square lattices, they map on the same point.
Tetragonal square.
Yes, it is quotient square, yes, or triangle. And what happens if I want to calculate distances between two square lattices or two hexagonal ones, for example?
Yeah, very good question. So if you have two square lattices, different scale, say size one, size two, then these two different square lattices will be represented by two different points on that line, on the blue line. Right? So here I considered only one square lattice as an example, but any point here on this blue line will represent a different square lattice, a larger one here. Okay, so if you have two different square lattices, we have two different points along this blue line, and the root metric by definition simply takes the distance, for example Euclidean distance, between these two points or on the blue line.
I was thinking about the triangle, because in the triangle, in a way, they are projected on the same point. So
that's right.
You have to go to the
representation. Because in the quotient triangle, the space is considered up to a weaker equivalence relation. So isometry composed with uniform scaling. And after uniform scaling, all square lattices are equivalent. Yeah, that's why naturally they are represented by a single point.
So uniform scaling, you mean kind of, it's a kind of affine transformation. So it's not isometry anymore.
That's right. Yes. Uniform scaling is affine transformation when we simply multiply all vectors by the same scalar.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Mois, any other questions?
I would like to say in response to Mois's question that basically, in the way that crystallographers think about this in three dimensions, in the projected case, it's what you would use for identifying Bravais lattice types. And in the non-projected, it's for how different two lattices are. So in two dimensions, yeah, you can, you know, all of the square lattices project to the same place. And so it's a technique for identifying the Bravais types in the two-dimensional cases here.
So also in three dimensions, you see in the triangular cone, the Bravais class of tetragonal square lattices.
Right.
So this is a one-dimensional line within a three-dimensional space.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And this orange line is the Bravais class of hexagonal lattices. Again, one-dimensional within three dimensions.
Yeah, this is in three dimensions what our paper in 2014 was about. Exactly. Not done so simply, I think.
You mean three-dimensional lattices?
Yes, exactly.
Right. Oh, okay, yeah.
Not two-dimensional in our case.
Yeah, yes. You see, today we are talking about simpler ambient dimension two only. But you see, configuration space has three parameters. So three-dimensional. Okay, but lattices are two-dimensional. Right. Right. If there are no questions on the previous content, then let's talk about metrics on lattices considered up to rigid motion. So the root metric on mirror images is simply zero, because these two mirror images are isometric, but we need to distinguish them up to rigid motion. So first simple case, if two lattices have the same sign, well, the same sign, or one of them has sign zero, which means it is mirror symmetric. Then in this case, our root metric or orientation aware root metric is simply the same. So no changes, we similarly compute the distance between root invariants. But if lattices have opposite signs, then the formula is a bit more complicated. So it's a formal definition. We consider all intermediate mirror symmetric lattices which have sign zero and take the sum. So it's a path from our first lattice to mirror symmetric lattice to the second lattice. So we take the minimum, the shortest length of this path necessarily through an intermediate mirror symmetric lattice. So you'll see a geometric interpretation shortly, but let me mention that first, I have written down this formula, which was rather natural geometrically, and later discovered that in the theory of metric spaces of non-positive curvature, actually this is a partial case of a much more general so-called quotient metric. So if you have two different metric spaces, we could consider a gluing of these two spaces over an isometry on, say, on a common subspace, and then define a new quotient metric on this larger union. So this is actually a partial case of a more general formula. So the metric axioms here are a bit harder to prove. All proofs are in the paper, so I will not mention them here. And now let me explain it geometrically. So the formula was for the root metric, but for the projective metric is absolutely the same. So we have two lattices, lambda one, lambda two, of different signs. So it means that in the quotient square, we are in these two different triangles. So one sign is positive, another sign is negative. Then geometrically, it's rather simple. We simply take the length for the straight path. So for the Euclidean distance, but you could imagine, well, it should be possible for any other base metric, right? But we use here, so in the formula, we use only projected invariants, right? Because the projected metric takes invariants without a sign. So what essentially we do, we take a mirror image of that point, lambda two minus. So we get now a different lattice. It's mirror image lambda two plus in the yellow triangle. Now we have two lattices or two invariants in the same triangle. And when the formula minimizes the sum, so minimizes the total length of this path, so touching the boundary and then going to lambda two plus. So the formula from the previous slide simply says that this minimum shortest path from lambda between projected invariants, it corresponds to the shortest distance in the quotient square. But the formula uses only projected invariants in the yellow triangle. Okay, so this was a probably rather difficult mathematical argument. yeah, from school geometry. So let me try maybe differently. So see here, I have demonstrated the shortest path that goes through the hypotenuse, right? To go to the hypotenuse and then to lambda 2 plus. But the minimum should be taken over the whole boundary. So in principle, there could be a shortest path here. So we should actually compare and take one of these three minima. Right? Yeah, there will be formula explaining exactly what, but hopefully the geometric minimum is obvious. So these two other cases are demonstrated in other pictures. So basically for the orientation away metric, we still take the shortest path, but to compute it in terms of projected invariance, it's a bit more convenient to write down the formula as the minimum of two lengths. Otherwise it will, we need to take into account coordinates, so the definition will be, say, less invariant than the previous formula. Questions? Any questions? Okay, so let me return to the formula and highlight what here we take. Well, it's called infinium because we minimize over all mirror symmetric lattices, and the subspace of mirror symmetric lattices is formally not closed because one point is excluded. That's why formally I write the infinium, not the minimum, because we need additionally justify that this minimum exists. And for simple distances, say for Euclidean distance, or actually for any Minkowski distance, yes, it will be possible. So we will write down explicit formally. So this minimization here is actually not a problem. It's only a simple way to give a definition. But now let me explain how to compute it. Well, exactly. So Matt has implemented already all these computations. In the simple case, when lattices have the same sign, well, the formulae are straightforward, but for different opposite signs, if you start from two different lattices, so different root invariants, that's how we compute this orientation away metric based on the Euclidean distance. We simply compare three Euclidean distances in R3 from the original point of the first lattice, from the root invariant of the first lattice, to the three other points. So they may look a bit strange for you. However, if you have understood the previous slide, then these points are simply mirror images of the root invariant of lambda 2 with respect to three boundary planes. So in the previous picture, it was for the quotient triangle. But similarly, in three dimensions, we should consider three boundary planes of our triangular cone and then take the minimum over these three possibilities, over three potential shortest paths. So we compute with three distances, take the minimum. That's it. That's the whole minimization. And similarly, for the projective invariant of the distance for lattices of different signs is computed as the minimum of only three Euclidean distances from the projected invariant of one lattice to three mirror images of the projected invariant of the second lattice. Now these mirror images are taken with respect to the vertical edge of the triangle. So x2 changes its sign with respect to the horizontal edge. And this is a mirror image with respect to the hypotenuse. So exactly as well as shown in these three examples, we simply take the minimum of three potential distances. So this one, and that one. So we have similar formulae obtained for the Minkowski distance with the parameter infinity. And I'm pretty sure it's actually possible to write down formally even for any q. We simply didn't have time to do these technical computations because we already happy with the Euclidean distance as a base distance. Okay. Now let me move to chiralities, because this is also an interesting topic. So if you have understood metrics, then let's think how we can use this metrics. We can use this metrics to understand how a lattice is not, say, sufficiently symmetric. So how far away a lattice is from a lattice being mirror symmetric. Okay, a bit more formally. In the plane, there are four crystallographic point groups of lattices. Any oblique lattice or generic lattice has the group in Schoenflies notation C2. So it means that the lattice is simply centrally symmetric with respect to the origin. But sometimes there are extra symmetries. So if you have an orthorhombic lattice, rectangular or centered rectangular, then we have not only central symmetry, we actually have two mirror symmetries on orthogonal axis. Tetragonal point group means that it is a square lattice, so you have symmetries of a square and symmetries of a regular hexagon in the last case. So it's convenient to have a formal notation then. So lease G, lattice isometry space restricted to the group G, is formally the closure of the subspace of all lattices with the crystallographic point group G. So we need this notation to define the following chiralities. So the word chirality usually means a binary property. So yes or no. So well, an object, example, a molecule or a crystal, so in our case, a lattice, well, it is equivalent to its mirror image through rigid motion. And previously you have seen that sign of a lattice actually can be considered as this binary chirality. So sign can be positive or negative, or zero if you have a mirror symmetric object. But now we can continuously quantify chirality. So how far away a lattice from being more symmetric. So if you fix a group G, so in our case, G will be D2, D4, D6 only. So three possibilities. So in each case, we could define the root chirality as the minimum distance. So the minimum root metric to the subspace of lattices with that group G. And this metric will have physical coordinates. So since root metric is measured, for example, in angstroms, then chirality will be also in angstroms. Projected invariant has no units because we have divided by the sum of root products. So it's unitless, and similarly, this chirality is unitless. Both chiralities are not negative, but real valid, so they are continuous. They continuously change. So we have actually, again, a formal statement of this continuity, but since the underlying space is continuous, it's easy for you to see this continuity. And I think, yes, I have a geometric interpretation here. So the case of projected chiralities when we consider the quotient triangle. So let me start actually from the case of D6. So chirality with respect to D6 means that we measure the deviation of a lattice from the closest hexagonal lattice. So for the projected chirality, simply the distance to the top vertex of this triangle. For the root chirality, so a bit more complicated, it will be a distance from root invariant to the boundary line of all hexagonal lattices in the triangular column. But similarly, simply the distance to that one-dimensional subspace of hexagonal lattices. Similarly, for square lattices, so square lattices represented by a single point in the quotient square, that's why simply compute the distance to that point. And the most interesting case here is the chirality with respect to mirror symmetry, so with respect to D2 group, when we take the minimum. So we have three potential closest neighbors on three sides of the quotient triangle. That's why we take the minimum of these three distances. Any questions on this geometric interpretation?
I'm sorry to interfere again, but I had difficulties. You said, or if I have understood incorrectly. So you say you measure chirality in angstroms? Did you say that?
Absolutely.
Okay, for me, chirality is a kind of property, as you said it before. So
binary.
Maybe one has to change the terminology or?
Well, yeah, we have discussed. So so don't remember. So with you and with Larry Andrews, I think as well. Another potential name was dissymmetry. Dissymmetry. So we have considered this word as well for that continuous concept. Our conclusion so far was to keep the word chirality. Yes, it is not binary. So it's not a binary property. It is now a continuous real valued function. Do you think it will be too confusing?
Uh-huh. No, but I mean that chirality is a well-defined property. I mean, and just to introduce or to have this additional meaning to chirality could be quite misleading, at least for me. I mean, I don't know, maybe I'm not right, but it's...
I think that the crystallographer thinks about chirality exactly as you say, Moise. But for instance, the organic chemist often thinks about chiral molecules that are that can invert. And so you go from one chirality continuously through a mirror plane and onto the other. And I think that to the organic chemist, it would make sense to measure that distance from one configuration to the other as a continuous measure.
No, one can measure it, but there is no need to call it chirality. This is
then we would need to find another good name for it. But yes, I understand. I think we both understand here.
Yes. So could you suggest a better name then?
Well, I mean, I have to think, but so let me just think. But I mean, chirality is really misleading. I mean, just the phrase. Measuring chirality in tangstroms is for me.
Yeah, I. It's Nick Kotov. Thanks a lot for interesting thinking about it. I have to agree with other people that chirality in principle is scaleless. So it should be applicable to any scale. I mean, angstrom scale, at nanometer scale, and like. Mm-hmm. So to measure it in a particular value of angstroms or other measures, except if it's not in it's an arbitrary units, to me it would be very strange.
Well, so I understand potential confusion. Okay, so my argument is that previously, so people a long time ago in ancient Greece, they started from integer numbers, rational numbers, and then they discovered irrational numbers, right? But they still called them numbers, right? They didn't invent a different word. Yes, irrational numbers and then complex numbers, right? So they're still roots of equations, right? So the word evolved, the concept of a number evolved over time. This is exactly what we are suggesting. So previously, chirality was a binary property.
What's actually right? Not. Actually, I have to argue here too. If you, would argue that the index which was created by Hausdorff or Mislow or Osipov, who was also in UK at that point, also implies the continuum of chirality. It's not just plus and minus, it's not just L and S, L and D, but it's a continuum real function. And what I hear here is actually very much reminds me the Osipov Zandbur pickup index. It also positive and negative, so it's a little different definition, but by and large, it has the same properties as what you suggest here, no?
Possibly, so I didn't know about this. Did you say Osipov index? How is it called?
Yeah, I can email you his paper. Osipov pickup Dunmore.
Okay, yes. So I would be very happy, for more references. Of course, we are only learning here crystallography and chemistry, so we would be happy for more references. So index, so usually in mathematics, index means something integer. So that's why I would prefer, a more continuous concept.
It's not integer. I agree with that. So it's called index, but I mean, it's like, the number as you mentioned. I'll be happy to email you, that paper.
Please. So we are welcome so we could probably organize a competition of names.
It's
so how to call it? So another possibility was dissymmetry. So dissymmetry, and actually Lagrange considered many years ago something similar, so called dissymmetry. But you see, it's a bit long, a bit complicated, and also. Maybe we could easily change in principle.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. So let me move towards we need to finish soon. So let's skip with properties. I'll show the formula for this for a moment called chirality, root chirality with respect to the group D2. So it's a deviation, so a distance to the closest mirror symmetric lattice. So computed in terms of the root invariant of a given lattice and even simpler formula for the projected chirality. So deviation from a projected invariant to a mirror symmetric lattice. So there are more formulae, even here for our Minkowski parameters. So now let me show you the histograms that Matt recently obtained. So remember, when you take a real crystal from a Cambridge structural database, so it's given with a lattice. So lattice has three basis vectors, and from these three vectors, we take three pairs. So we essentially take three two-dimensional lattices embedded in our real crystal. So that's how we get millions of lattices extracted from real crystals. So here you see the histogram of chiralities multiplied by the sign, right? So remember, lattices could have positive and negative sign, and also we removed actually lattices of sign zero. Otherwise, of course, there will be a huge peak here at zero. But if you remove these mirror symmetric lattices, this is the distribution of distances, essentially deviations from hexagonal lattices. So that's how all other oblique lattices differ, so how far away they are from hexagonal lattices. This pair of histograms is for deviations from square lattices. So on the left, you see the chirality with respect to the root metric. Yes, in angstroms, and we removed a few outliers only to make it better visible. So, but Lorentz formally is not restricted on the left. Lorentz is actually restricted on the right because, remember, in the quotient triangle, we simply measure a distance from an interior point to the vertex. So for this particular case, it's between minus one and one. But the shapes are similar, so only scales are a little bit different. And the most interesting case is deviations from mirror symmetric lattices. So this peak actually corresponds not to the case sine equal to zero, because we removed all mirror symmetric lattices. This peak corresponds to lattices that are very close to being mirror symmetric. So they're slightly not symmetric, and still there are many of them. So what is interesting here is a preference for positive lattices. So we have certain preference towards lattices of positive sign. And I don't exactly understand why. Maybe Larry, do you have any ideas why?
Yeah, I do have a suggestion. For primitive lattices, primitive orthorhombic and primitive monoclinic, it is conventional, though not required, to sort the indices in order of A less than B less than C, if you can easily do it. And that would lead to exactly this dissymmetry, because for the non-primitives, you're going to get a different case because of cell reduction. But for the primitives, they will show that asymmetry.
Probably. So probably this is simply this artifact of additional sorting.
I'm quite sure that that would contribute.
Right. Is there any way to avoid that, or not really?
Well, not if you're going to have that convention. I mean, basically, it's for the primitive lattices, it's a cell reduction. But see, the thing is, if you were to only plot the primitives, I suspect what you would see is a vastly more exaggerated difference between the two sides.
We will try. Yeah, we will check. Yeah, thank you for your
Because probably there would be almost nothing on the left side, at least for the primitive orthorhombics.
Yeah, we will check. Okay.
Yep.
Yeah, thank you, Larry. Thank you very much. So let me finish with this plot that you have seen in the previous talk, because it shows, well, two-dimensional picture. So previously it was only histograms, but since we have a few participants who see this approach for the first time, this is a density map of all oblique lattices. So again, we removed all mirror symmetric, so the diagonal is empty, the edges are empty, so we can see the only the interior of these triangles. And yes, there is still maybe artificial preference for positive lattices, but that's what we have in the CSD. That's how crystals are deposited. Right, so the main conclusion, so right at 3 o'clock is the same, but you have seen a lot of crystals mapped on the underlying continuous space. So we didn't see any large gaps, and indeed these white regions are easily explained because this corner should be empty because cells are too long, they're too elongated, and real crystals, of course, should not have such cells at all. So, but apart from that, there are no other gaps. So almost the whole space is filled by lattices from real crystals. And formally, we have checked that almost a half of all these lattices are generic, so they belong to the Bravais class of oblique lattices, 45%. Okay, so thank you very much for your time today. Next time, we'll discuss three-dimensional lattices, but that's it for now. So I'll stop recording, and then if you have time, If you have time, we'll have a discussion.